Jesus reigns above the tyranny of gravity. He intends for us to rise above depravity. Nearly time to fly away from sin's calamity, to embrace the one who offers us an amnesty. Hey guys, I thought I'd give it a try with a new intro here. It's my first foray into anything like that, so hopefully it didn't come across too shabby. Be fun if I could play an instrument, but I don't play instruments, so, which is a weird thing for a songwriter to say, but it's the truth. Anyway, the name of this video is When Jesus Said He'd Be Back. And what it is the first little bit of intro into a book I am trying to write. The hardest thing about writing a book for me is keeping myself encouraged. But I believe that the Lord has given me some insight. So I think that I really do have to follow through with it. It's an act of love for him. I have a heart for those folks that are going to be here during the tribulation times. People do not realize just how immediate the rapture is. And they get themselves in a furor over things that about the wrath of God being poured out. And the wrath of God is being poured out on the lawless. And it's going to be an interesting thing, because I believe that the wrath of God, which is primarily poured out in the last half of the tribulation period, will be brought down by the acts and things that take place in the first half of the tribulation period. I don't think it's just accumulated wrath from all of the thousands of years of sin. I really do think that it's going to be over that first 3.5 years and the evil that's done. But anyway, we're going to get into that in the book. I'm going to try and put these things online, because I have no sense whatsoever as far as how to market things or whatnot. And I don't think it's going to be enough time to really, you know, do anything more than what I'm doing. It's possible that somebody that the Lord will put a burden on their heart and open doors where I don't know how to open them. But anyway, when Jesus said he'd be back, and this is a quote from Matthew 24, 32 and 33. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender, and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Jesus didn't just throw this out there helter-skelter. This was in direct answer to questions posed by the disciples present, recorded in verse 3. They had all just taken in the majesty and grandeur of the temple of God, the pride of Israel. As God's chosen nation, Israel hosted the only divinely ordained temple of his worship. It was a symbol of the unique heritage they had, and still have, hearkening back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and confirmed again in power with Moses. Entrusted with the worship of the Lord, the Jews would defend the temple until they as a nation were destroyed and unable to do so. And Jesus had just prophesied the temple's destruction. The disciples knew that meant Israel would be destroyed and its survivors scattered. It must have felt as though he had just yanked the rug out from under them. They wondered when this would happen, when he would return to set things right, and when Israel would cease to be threatened by the world around them. This parable was the sign he gave them. The fig tree was traditionally where a son of Israel could find cover from the sun and rest. As a place of rest, it came to symbolize the borders of the nation itself. Ezekiel had also prophesied that Israel, though destroyed and long dead among nations, would one day be reconstituted, established anew. And that comes out of Ezekiel 37, the Valley of Dry Bones prophecy. Jesus reaffirmed the prophecy with his parable. When the fig tree, that is Israel, puts forth leaves, his return is near. As a tree is recognized by the leaves it produces, so Israel was established and recognized in its borders. The sign fulfilled on May 14, 1948. But there's more. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Matthew 24, and that's 34 and 35. When a generation is mentioned in Scripture as a measure of time, one of two meanings is implicit. Either the productive years of a generation is intended, age 20 to 60, totaling 40 years, or the years appointed to a man's life as a rule laid out in Scripture, 70 years, according to Psalm 91:10. Since Jesus mentions that this generation shall not pass, it's plain he's referring to actual lifespan. In verse 30, the last of all these things to be fulfilled is described. Jesus returned to rule all the nations that the disciples longed to see take place. The generation that saw Israel reborn will live to see Christ set foot on the Mount of Olives. I'm going to repeat that one. The generation that saw Israel reborn will live to see Christ set foot on the Mount of Olives. May 14th, 1948. Plus 70 years equals 2018. 7 years removed for tribulation, which ends with Christ setting foot on the Mount of Olives, goes behind us to 2011. That means that this generation is on borrowed time already. He is prolonging the lifetime of this last generation so that all who are willing to receive mercy have time to do so. The church will be called home any day now. I didn't say it. Jesus said it. I just thought about it. Anyway, love you, brethren. And to all of the fellow watchers out there, keep on watching. We are very, very close. I think it's interesting that the Lord said that when leaves begins to bring forth leaves and the branch becomes tender, that summer is nigh. I've noticed when I speak in tongues, the word Verano has come out a couple of different times. I don't know what the Lord's talking about, but Verano in Spanish means summer. So, anyway, love you, brethren. We'll see what happens. But we live in an exciting times. We'll talk to you next time. Bye-bye.